Welcome to this Sharing in the Local Inner West Economy podcast, produced by the Green Living Centre for Footprints Online and Inner West Library as part of their speaker series. To begin with, I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which this podcast was produced and is being broadcast, the Gadigal and Wangal peoples of the Eora Nation, and pay my respects to elders past, present and future. I extend this to the lands where our guests are recording and where people are listening from. This is, and always will be, Aboriginal land. So the topic we are discussing is the share economy, how it works, its benefits, particularly why it's good for the environment, and ways you can get involved locally. And to do that, I'm joined by a wonderful panel of young women who are involved in the share economy in a variety of ways, and who are creating solutions at the local level. So we have Inka Santala, a PhD research candidate at the University of Wollongong. Her project explores sharing cities and the potential of community-based sharing initiatives to create new capacities and agency in the urban political context. So welcome, Inka.
Yeah, thank you, Emma.
We also have Amy Croucher, who in January 2019 launched the Inner West Tool Library, a community organisation allowing residents to access hundreds of tools and useful things. Welcome, Amy.
Thanks very much, Emma.
And thirdly, joining us is Ellie Bramborova, who with her husband Thomas founded ShareWaste, an app that connects people who don't have the capacity to compost to be able to do so, with now over 66,000 people participating. Welcome to you, Ellie.
Thank you, Emma.
For some people listening, the share economy may be something that they're already engaging in, maybe without even realising. For example, using your local library. Libraries being one of the originators leading the way, a mainstay of the share economy. To others, this term may be a new concept. The share economy comes in various forms and under different names, including collaborative consumption, and is part of the broader circular economy. It really describes how we can share resources, where we are seeing resources or stuff being used over and over or passed on to others. It can be transferred really to any activity, skill or space, and involves products from cars and bikes to plants and food waste. It took off in 2010 when Rachel Botsman and Rue Rogers published their book What's Yours is Mine and shone a light on the extent and explosion of sharing, bartering, focusing on how we consume and access resources, described in this book as systems and marketplaces that match needs and have underused assets in ways that create greater efficiency and access. Starting with you, Inka, how would you describe the share economy? What would you say it is all about?
What would probably be the easiest way to describe the sharing economy is thinking of it as community members connecting with each other to share space, skills, and other resources, often mediated through an online platform. This sharing can include anything from open skill sharing workshops or swapping of homegrown produce to share housing or organizing around community energy production. So it might involve lending, borrowing, bartering, collaborative consumption or production, and also be organized either by individuals themselves, more or less formal community groups, or then be facilitated by the local council, as your example here about the city libraries.
Great. And Amy, how would you describe the share economy?
I think that yourself, Emma, and Inka really covered a lot of it. I think it's really important that it is part of the wider circular economy, trying to move away from the linear economy of take, make, waste, trying to make use of the things that already exist. So keeping materials and products in use at their highest value. So that's sort of, I suppose, the environmental side of things. But I think it's really, especially at the grassroots level, about connection, like Inka was saying, a lot of community getting together to make this happen.
I think for me, the boundaries are not so clear. But in general, I see it as an economic model where two or more parties share their underutilized assets or skills. And usually this relationship is facilitated through a common marketplace. Sometimes it's an online platform, such in the case of ShareWaste. For me also, what is really important is what is the main drive. I think it's really important that the main drive is not profit, as we could see in some cases of really useful initiatives where their purposes changed completely when they started to be more profit-driven, such as Airbnb. I think it's really good that one of the positive effects is that it changes the approach to ownership and it starts the buy less, share more thinking this model encourages.
I'm also thinking about, you know, what you're all doing, individual perspective. So I might start with you, Inka, and ask you to tell us a little bit about what your research has found.
Currently doing my research on sharing cities, aiming particularly to document and understand the emergence and organization of these more community-based sharing initiatives in Sydney. In 2018, I was involved in a project called The Sharing Map, where we invited the community members to build an online database of all the sharing resources existing in the city. And as you can see, if you access the sharingmap.com.au, there are plenty of community and creative spaces located also in the Inner West. Some examples I could give you include the Inner West Woman Shed as a creative community that is based around skill sharing. That is a street repair cafe where you can learn to fix your own electronic appliances. The Crop Swap Sydney, that allows members to swap homegrown produce to reduce food waste. And of course, the great initiatives of the Inner West Tool Library and Share Waste, which I'm sure Amy and Ellie will tell you more about.
Yeah, Amy, maybe you can talk us through how the Inner West Tool Library came about and what the benefits you've seen it's brought to the community.
Yeah, so basically, I mean, the Inner West Tool Library is basically just a 100% volunteer community-run organization, and it's just like a book library but loaning out tools and other useful things. It's actually not an online platform like many of the other share economy initiatives are. We have a physical space where people can come and borrow things. The whole tool library is based around the idea that you don't need a drill, you need a hole in the wall. So it all started when I wanted to make some outdoor furniture from pallets. I needed the tools to do that, but didn't want to go and buy them all and spend the money, knowing I'd only use it once or twice a year, if that. I'm out about tool libraries, and at the time there was only two very new ones in Australia and not one in Sydney, so I thought I'd start one in the Inner West, so not only I could take advantage of it, but obviously the whole community could as well. Took part in the Inner West Council Community Leaders course, which really helped with local connections and getting it up and running and giving me the confidence to really put it out to the community. It's a pretty basic concept. You sign up as a member, pay a membership fee, and you can come in on a Saturday morning and borrow anything you need and take it home for the week and bring it back. We have a lot more than just tools. It's like camping gear and sporting equipment and kitchen appliances. There's like over 300 items in there, which I suppose really leads into the benefits, because not only is it obviously good for the environment, using the things that already exist, and people are able to donate their tools if they're moving or they don't use them anymore. So reducing that need for new products to be created. But I think really importantly, and surprised me, I suppose, along this journey, how much more is the social aspect of it, really building community resilience, people meeting their neighbours and supporting each other. And I think that's more important than ever, considering, you know, in 2020, considering COVID-19 and the bushfires earlier this year, really just bringing those people together.
Yeah, I'm so blown away by like your list of all the things that you've got now available for people to make use of. So it's such a great initiative. And I'm so impressed with yours, Ellie, too. You know, you started Share Waste back in 2016. It's another amazing model of how you can get the share economy working. So maybe you could talk to us about that, you know, how it works and what have been some of the successes or even surprises to make this project work for you.
So we started Share Waste with my husband, Thomas, and our initial idea was to give people who couldn't compost the chance to recycle their organic waste locally. Our main motivation behind the idea was to show that food scraps or organic waste in general are a valuable resource. We should use it in our gardens rather than waste it in landfills. And also because we are quite new to the area, We wanted to know people locally, and we wanted for other people to get to know each other within their community. That's why we started ShareWaste. At the moment, it's a volunteer-run platform and a free app available for web, Android, and iPhone. Anybody can download it. It's a matching app, so it's sometimes people call it the Tinder for compost. So we have two types of users: compost hosts and food scraps donors. A compost host is anybody who can accept extra organic waste than they produce themselves, or sometimes it's people with chickens or other farm animals who can feed the scraps to them. And donors, on the other hand, are very often apartment dwellers, or sometimes they are composters who can't compost at the moment, or who have just moved houses and don't have their own compost bin yet. If I should explain how it basically works, the compost hosts have a marker on the map and a listing with information about the items they can accept in their compost or for their animals, such as chickens. And registered donors can choose those local hosts on the map, send them a message via the app, and offer them their scraps. And if the local host accepts, they can start a conversation, they can arrange the details of the first drop-off, and the donor can start contributing. So we started with no markers on the map, and we didn't know anybody. At the moment, we know so many great local initiatives all around the world and individuals who joined and who brought other people on ShareWaste. So that was one of the surprises. And I think the other one was that an individual actually can have a really great and far-reaching impact. And many of our compost hosts or donors are actually proofs of that.
COVID has seen the rise of, you know, mutual aid groups that often are community-led. Inka, you might like to, as you say, respond to this sort of coming together, this sort of social aspect of building trust and connections.
Yes, the pandemic has been disruptive as for our daily lives, but also for many of these community-based sharing initiatives that are already working, many of them in restricted resources and volunteer labor in the city. So some of these have had to reconsider their organization or shut down temporarily. But also what the global situation has shed light on is exactly the importance of these sort of grassroots economies, the mutual aid groups, and kind of community resourcefulness in general. What we have seen here locally is a growing importance and call for informal mutual aid groups like the Pay Forward, the Inner West, where people use social media to connect for sharing excess food produce or give away previously loved items or clothes they no longer wear. Also, the community gardens and food pantries have been a great way for people to access fresh produce. There's been encouragement for that neighborhood assistance that has been something usually considered as disappearing in the more hectic urban life. So in many ways, the situation with COVID has demonstrated the need for these sort of community projects, not only in terms of accessing resources and saving money, which is of course important, but also for that sense of connection and togetherness in the face of crisis. And what I found through my own research was that many of these community members I interviewed did find that participating in the community-based sharing had increased their trust on other people or enabled them to build that kind of new sort of connection to the local community that they did not previously have.
Like you say, many of the share initiatives make use of different technologies, you know, like Pay It Forward. And I wondered, Ellie, if you have any other sort of examples or experiences that you have seen contributing to the share economy just through, you know, your initiatives.
People actually were and are active on ShareWaste even during the times of COVID. Those who were used to meeting their host or donor in person switched to contactless drop-offs. And even if they stopped sharing for a while, we still encourage them to stay in touch through the app. So I think now it's more important than ever before to be in touch, even if the people can't see each other in person. for us, from the very beginning, the community aspect for shareways was very important. So that's why we encourage these connections to happen.
And how about you, Amy? What have you found during this time?
The library had to close for a couple of months, sort of during the peak of COVID and lockdown. But we did open up. And since then, even during that time, people were still really wanting to access it. Probably because people were at home and, you know, had more time to actually do things around the house. So when we opened back up, the first weekend was super busy. So it's been consistent since then, I think. And even just, like I said before, people sort of meeting their neighbours and helping each other, that sort of come out of it a bit more. Maybe not sort of doing something in their own home, but doing something for someone else, which is really great to see.
To you, Ellie, just around the, you know, use of technologies, yours is an app-based kind of share initiative. So what do you think the advantages and maybe disadvantages of that have been?
So for us, actually, the technology is only a tool. It's not the main thing. It's just a really convenient tool how to bring people together. If we didn't have the apps, we would never be able to bring so many people together, and we wouldn't be able to create a decentralized system where people can get to know their neighbors locally. So this way we can encourage people, from instance, from the top north or in Europe, to get to know each other through the app, even though we've never been there physically and we don't know those people in person.
Take on technology being just a tool and enabler, but also the main focus should be on the user friendliness and enabling of that sharing interaction. For example, the shareways starting locally and now being spread globally through different local contexts, that tells about the usability and convenience of people on that platform.
Hopefully people are interested in starting a share initiative, or, you know, looking for other places where they might find out more. So maybe each of you, if you'd like to recommend to our listeners either, you know, how they can get involved in your projects, or, you know, other share initiatives that you would recommend to them. So maybe we'll start with you, Amy.
Yeah, sure. So with the Inner West Tool Library, anyone can become a member or donate or volunteer with us. They can just go to our website, innerwesttoollibrary.com.au, or search for us in Facebook, join up there. You can also check out all the inventory that we've got there and reserve things online. Alternatively, you could just pop by one Saturday morning and come have a chat with us. We're located underneath the Petersham Bowling Club from 9 till 12 every Saturday morning. And it's actually a really great sort of little place to be there. And people just come by for a chat and see what we've got, and like might sort of have a chat about the projects that they've got going on. So it's a really nice sort of social space as well there. Yeah, so all the membership fees just go to insurance and maintenance of our space. And I just wanted to actually put a shout out to our volunteers, because really, it wouldn't exist without the volunteers there. So they have a great time in there and really, really share their experience with the community too. And I think just touching on what other sort of initiatives that I'm sort of, I suppose, take part in, I think like street libraries around the place are a really good example of little localized sharing economy. Car share. I don't own a car in the Inner West, so I use Car Next Door, so I can use my neighbor's car just when I need it. And I think it might be a bit internationally, but couchsurfing.org I've always used in the past. It's like Airbnb, but not profit driven.
Yeah, I've heard lots of stories about people doing that. And again, that was one of the originators, wasn't it, of getting the share economy happening around, you know, in people's consciousness. And what about you, Ellie? Is there anything else you wanted to add about them, you know, supporting your initiative, or what you would recommend, other local things that you've seen happening?
Yeah, so if people wish to join Shareways, they can visit our website on shareways.com and create a compost host listing or register as donors. And if they just don't want to register yet, they can browse the map and see all the places where people are hosting already. Or they can join us on our Facebook or Instagram.
In addition to these two great initiatives, if you're looking other ways to getting involved in the sharing movement, I think a good starting place is to have a look also at the Sharing Map website and have a look what's already happening in your neighborhood or in the city more broadly. And one advice would be not to be too afraid to go along, because many times I speak with people who have never heard about the share economy, and once they get along, they find it actually not only useful for themselves, getting access to resources, saving money, and getting those social connections, but also they find the joy of helping others.
Just recognizing the sharing behaviors that are already out there and then building on them is definitely something we can all sort of a way to approach it. Like, for example, myself, I've always collected seed and shared seed. So that's been an ongoing part of my sharing space for many years. What else can we do more of, do you think, to make the share economy thrive? You know, what is it, what's sort of missing, or what do you think we might need to help push it?
I would say just promote it, to shift the mind flow from, I want something, so where do I buy it, into more like, I want something, how can I use it without buying it, where I can gain access? Because for most items, buying shouldn't be the first option.
Well, I think for the tool library on a local level, it's, I think, really showing the benefits of being a member and being a part of something like this. Because we've got, I'm a bit of a data nerd, so I've got sort of all our impact from our first year being open. So we had 200 members, over 1,100 loans in that year. And
wow,
economically, like, we've saved our members over $93,000 in that first year. So just from our top borrower, $75 to join, and she, from everything that she borrowed, she saved over $2,200. So I think showing people the, because not everyone's into the environmental side of it, and to show them the other benefits of it too. From the environmental side, though, we saved over a ton from landfill in our first year, and over 4 tons of new products needing to be manufactured. And also just to come along on the day and have a chat, because I think really the social side of it and sense of belonging and connecting to your wider community and the volunteers learning new skills is really, there's so many different facets of this that you can, like, people can benefit from. I also just wanted to touch on, I suppose, spreading the word wider. I'm being the share economy, I'm all about sharing the knowledge as well. I've been regularly contacted by other community groups and individuals all around Australia wanting to set something up like this in their area. When I first started, there was 2 in Australia, and now I think there's around 20. So it's really fantastic to see that there's more exposure to these, and people are starting to understand it a bit more. And I think it's really about sort of sharing that just information around different communities and just from the impact of it, just showing what your own individual choice can actually collectively have a big impact.
Yes, I would like to just extend on what Amy started about the environmental benefits. I think that's an important discussion, and also the social impact. So there has been plenty of research on the possibility of sharing to support more sustainable resource use, the increased efficiency, and that way reduce the level of consumption. But these are, of course, really the case only if they're supported with proper policy guidelines, as well as the shifting of the consumer and user mindsets. That's what my research is mainly interested in, but also what are the more immaterial social outcomes of these sharing initiatives. By this, I mean the often hard to measure social changes in terms of realizing or wanting to experience new ways of being and doing in the city, different to the contemporary competitive and marketing case norms, or building a new understanding of oneself, not only as a passive user and consumer of services produced by others, but also a more active enabler, maker, and co-creator of these shared assets and services. So thus enabling that new realization of the city and economy as not something being regulated or managed from above, but becoming something more flexible and co-created, actualizing right here through our own actions and behaviors. And to support that, I think it is really crucial to demonstrate what's already out there, how people are making these alternatives happen in the city. So enabling people to get to know about these practices, discuss what means to share rather than own. And also the local government can do a lot here, leading by example, enabling and facilitating those local community projects. As we can see from Amy and Eli, the educational programs and training projects are really important for people to get that first incentive to start projects.
You have all demonstrated through our discussion today, and also obviously Inka through your research, and with Amy and Ellie, your very concrete, amazing examples of the share economy, you know, why it is so good for the planet, you know, and reducing waste, lowering our carbon footprint, and really building the resilience in our communities. You know, this is a library podcast, so I just wondered if you may have other resources or books that you'd recommend that people could go to, you know, if they wanted to dive a little bit deeper into this topic.
If any, well, for the Inner West listeners, I would recommend them to research the BEMA Films website, which they can access for free with their library card. And there are so many very interesting documentaries, including environmental documentaries and other. It's for free, so I can totally recommend that.
Ellie, thanks for that recommendation. It's amazing. I didn't know about that. The resource that I'd really recommend people can sort of go down a massive rabbit hole into is shareable.net. There's a lot of information about there about all sorts of share things from around the world.
And I think that's connected to the book Sharing Cities, Activating the Urban Commons. One of the co-authors is involved in that initiative. So, yeah, that's another great one. Thank you, Amy. It's been so wonderful to hear your perspectives on your share initiatives and the broad local share economy. So I can't thank you all enough for joining us today. And I really appreciate the time and all that you're doing in this area. So thank you to Inka, Amy and Ellie. For more of the Footprints online program and digital content from libraries, including more podcasts, go to the Footprints and Library pages on the Inner West Council website. Thank you.